all welcome to another transmission from the Lifelaw Institute. We are speaking inside still the general theme, the Gospel of John, Word, Life, and Edification. And we have reached message number 7 of this conference. Jesus came to this world that those who do not see may see. We saw in the last chapter that the Jews, especially the leaders of the Jews, they had the intention of killing Jesus did not want to lose their power structure, their privileges. And they did not have in their hearts the place to receive the Word of God through Jesus. And God said that all of this, the problem, and they insisted that their father was Abraham. And Jesus said that if Abraham was indeed their father, they should love him, because he was sent by the Father to do what the Father wanted. And they should not intend to kill him. At the end, Jesus was very clear with them that by that attitude, their father was the devil.
Porque nele não há verdade. Quando ele profere mentira, fala do que ele é próprio.
And chapter 8, verses 35 to 46, says, "You are of your father the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and does not stand in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it." We must seek to know who is our source. Our source should be the great I Am. Our source, our father, should be the real one, the only one that is real in this universe. So our source should be our God, the tree of life. Therefore, it's not a matter of good behavior, but a matter of you being connected to what tree? The tree of life, of the Garden of Eden. God planted in the Garden of Eden two trees and desired for the man to seek and choose the tree of life. But unfortunately, the serpent deceived the woman and led the man and woman to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And unfortunately, the vast majority of mankind walks by the tree, the knowledge of good and evil. No one likes evil, but at the same time, in this very tree, there's a bait that is the good. And every man wants to practice good. But the good and evil are from the same tree. And the tree has by source the devil. Therefore, who walks by the tree of knowledge of good and evil is blind. Therefore, in chapter 9, there's a picture for us. Now, as Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind from birth. And his disciples asked him, saying, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him. An evidence of who walks from the knowledge, from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, is for you to act by logic, by what is good and evil. That is, we see here in the second verse that even the disciples were deceived by this tree. Because they saw this blind man, and in their logic, they asked, who sinned so that this man was born blind? Was it him or his parents? Because by the logic of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, someone must have done something wrong for this to happen. And Jesus took this opportunity to teach the disciples that you must not judge by the knowledge of good and evil, of what is right and wrong. We must know how to judge the way God judges. So, neither this man nor his parents sinned, but that the works of God should be revealed in him. Jesus saw much blindness. Let us go back to John chapter 1, verse 10. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. And the saddest part is that he came to his own, and who was his own? The children of Israel, the nation of Israel. And his own did not receive him. So this is very, very sad. God made his son, that is, to come to this earth so that man can believe in the word and receive everlasting life. But man is used to live by what is right and wrong, by the tree of knowledge of good and evil. That's why the leaders of the Jew were blind. And we can see this in Mark, the Gospel of Mark, chapter 15, verse 10. He was delivered to die, that the chief priests had handed him over because of envy. And also, John chapter 5, verse 18.
Ainda mais procuravam
matá-lo. Therefore, the Jews sought all the more to kill him, because he not only broke the Sabbath, but also said that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. So these leaders of the Jews were blinded by religion, by the position that they occupied, and also by envy. And in John chapter 6, we can see various types of people who are blind. Chapter 6, not only the leaders of the Jews accepted Jesus and could not recognize that he was the envoy of God, the prophet Christ, and sought to kill him because he made himself equal to God. But also the people expected the Messiah that would come to the people, the Jewish people, to give them physical food and bread. Just like Moses did on the Old Testament with the manna. So the people wanted Jesus to be like Moses, transforming things into food and making them a very wealthy nation. But Jesus did not come with this mission, and therefore they also abandoned Jesus. And the third group is also in the 6th chapter, verse 60. Therefore, many of his disciples, when they heard this, said, "This is a hard saying." So the third group was his very own disciples, who thought that the words of Jesus was too harsh. Because Jesus said, "My flesh and whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed." So this word is very hard. How are we going to eat the flesh of Jesus and drink his blood? He's a madman. In a sense, the same thing today. We were so comfortable in the church life, and suddenly there came to be immersion. We were so used to our traditions, our conventional ways in the church. And there comes the teenagers doing war chants. And I can't accept this. And also, saints started to go out to the street, preaching the gospel, starting by, "May I pray for you? Just let me be in my church life, inside my four walls, please." But suddenly, the saints start to incentivize us to preach the gospel with the books, doing the cool party. Preaching The gospel of the kingdom. And people say, oh, I can't take this, this is too hard. Furthermore, they start encouraging us to go to PAC. And at that place, the one who led us were young people, giving us orders, go pray for that people, go pray at that table. What a crazy thing. Hard is this saying. Who can hear this? Jesus waited them, abandoned him first, then he explained it. You should believe to see, not see to believe. After these people how can I drink? And how can I eat the flesh? It's through the word. The words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life. So, the ones who thought that the saying was hard won't ever understand. But those who remain, they understood. Did you understand that the words are life and spirit? And in verse 64, we see that Jesus knew from the beginning who they were who did not believe. And who would betray him.
Ninguém poderá vir a mim se pelo Pai não lhe for concedido.
And he said, therefore, I have said to you that no one can come to me unless it has been granted to him by my Father. Do you want to be a part of these ones? I want to be a part of this group. So be simple. Don't be part of the group who do not believe. Don't be a traitor. You're going to be a part of the group that the Father delivered to Jesus for him to take care of. Verse 66, from that time many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Do you want to be a part of this group? And after this, Jesus said to the 12, do you also want to go away? You want to go away as well? Jesus does not, is not political in order for you to stay. He won't exchange favors for you to stay. He won't pay you $100 in order for you to stay. You stay if you want to. If you believe in the word, you stay. And what did Peter said? But Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. The words of Jesus take mankind to eternal life. To whom shall we go, saints? There is not a second person. There is no one. Jesus is the only one that has the words of eternal life. And the words that he has been giving to us are the words of eternal life. His words. Because in these last days, in Hebrews 1, verse 2, God has been speaking to us through his Son. What does he say on the first verse of Hebrews chapter 1? Verse 1. God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in times past to the fathers by the prophets. Does God speak or not? To the children of Israel, God spoke many times and in various ways. By the prophets. This is the meaning of the prophetic word. God speaks through the prophets. This is the word of God spoken to by the prophets. That's why we called it prophetic word. And in verse 2, we see he has, in these last few days, spoken to us by his Son. He has been speaking to us today through his Son. Where is his Son? The same way in verse 2, in verse 1, the Son speaks through his prophets. If God spoke through his prophets in the Old Testament, now in the age of the New Testament, is the Son who speaks. And he speaks through his prophets. It is the prophetic word. You can see here the blindness. The Jews could not see. The crowd sought the physical bread, blind. The many disciples who found his speech hard could not believe when Jesus spoke words outside of their logic. Only the fourth group stayed, because this group saw that Jesus has the word, had the words of eternal life. It is the only group who wasn't blind. Let us go to John chapter 8. Verse 23, and he said to them, you are from beneath, I am from above. You are of this world, and I am not of this world. Therefore I said to you that you will die in your sins. For you do not believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. Then they said to him, who are you? And Jesus said to them, just what I have been saying to you from the beginning. I have many things to say and to judge concerning you, but he who sent me is true. And I speak to the world those things which I heard from him. Jesus spoke the truth to the people. They, however, verse 27, did not understand that he spoke to them of the Father. Then Jesus said to them, when you lift up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself, but as my Father taught me. I speak these things, and he who sent me is with me. The Father has not left me alone, for I always do these things that please him. those things that please him. They didn't realize that he was the I am, himself, the real one. He not only was the creator, he was the existence himself. That's why he was able to cure the blind man. If he wasn't the true one, he could not have healed that man. Blindness is a result of man's fall by doubting and disobeying God's word, eating from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. I want you to appreciate this association, that the tree of knowledge of good and evil is associated with rebellion. God said that they should not eat from that tree, but they ate it. And because of their disobedience, blindness entered mankind. Do you realize? Blindness came through disobedience. Disobedience of the word of God. Thus, man, because he disobeyed God, eating from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, has disconnected himself from who? He disconnected himself from the one true one, the I am. He was disconnected from the true one and connected to whom? He was connected then to the Father of Lives. Then came blindness to this world. And the whole world is blind because of the doubt that the serpent put in Eve through the word of God. And through disobedience, through the rebellion, came blindness to the world. Let us go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I'm going to read from verse 3. But even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded. Who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. For we do not preach ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your bondservants for Jesus' sake. For it is the God who commanded light to shine out of darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. This blindness has a cure, thank God. So, Genesis chapter 3, the serpent put doubts in Eve's mind, asking, it is this what God truly said? Saints, take heed of people who call you, asking you, how are you? And it seems that their intention is concerning you, but their true intention is to put doubts. You should hang up right away. Don't listen to the words of the serpent. Is this truly the prophetic word? Does all of this truly work? Don't put doubts in the word of God, because when doubt enters your mind, it is over. And so the serpent offered of the tree of knowledge, and when they accepted, their eyes were opened. And like God said the serpent, they would know good and evil. And this, saints, is the corrupted mind. You are poisoned, your mind becomes corrupted, and you become a questioning person, critical, starting to judge everyone and everything, and you become unhappy. Everyone around you is happy, but not you. In 1980, there was a rebellion here among us. I was a young one, a young person, and many young people were poisoned. And then I started to visit these people, these saints, in order to help them. And you can help to listen to all these negative words. And I tried to help all of those I could. After I helped, I was positive, but I heard a lot of negative things. After hearing all these negative things, I realized that I have changed. How did I change? When I was here sitting, hearing the message of Brother Dong, I was thinking, he should not have said that, or he should not have said it this way. I was judging Brother Dong in this way. I was sitting here, everyone around me was enjoying, happy, and I was this critical person judging everything. The only one who was not enjoying. And my face, and you could see in my face that I had lost joy. And I realized that death entered me. And I asked the Lord, Lord, by your mercy, save me from this situation of death. Saints, death is harder to get rid of than your sin. When you sin, you can ask the Lord for forgiveness. But death takes a while to go away. When, thank God, I went back to the simplicity and started to enjoy again, I prayed to the Lord, Lord, do not ever let me lose the simplicity again. That's why, saints, you should not lose your purity and simplicity, because you will see the damage that death can do in you. That's why, saints, throughout human existence, Satan especially uses the good side of his soul to deceive men. His natural goodness and love his human efforts to please and serve God in religion. All of this is the source of man's blindness. Satan will not catch you through evil. No one likes evil. No one likes Satan. But he attracts you through the good part of your soul, your natural goodness, natural love, natural efforts. And when you bite that bait, death will come to you. The human concept governed by the tree of knowledge. There must be a logical reason for man to be born blind. But Jesus led them to himself as the tree of life. In the tree of life, there is no right and wrong. If you follow the way of God, there is no good and evil. What is right? To follow the Spirit. Let us follow the Spirit. Jesus did not come to earth for mere moral teaching with human rules of behavior. He, as the tree of life, wants to be presented to us in this manner. He took his time to do the works of the one who sent him and to bring light to those who were blind. And today, saints, God is also in a hurry to do his works. But to do that, he needs the word that proceeds out of his mouth through his envoy. Just as Jesus' words at that time would cure blindness, he came with this mission. But blindness didn't allow people to receive this help. That's why we need the word. Isaiah 55. I will read this verse again. I'm going to read from verse 8. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. Saints, the thoughts of God are not our thoughts, because we think of good and evil. We don't know how to discern the best he can do is still in the tree of knowledge of good and evil. His ways, his behaviors, are still in the earthly realm. But the ways of God are much more superior. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Don't limit the work of God through your thoughts. Don't limit the way God does his works through our logical ways, our own logical ways. Don't be the judge of what God is doing. Lord, I don't think it is this way. I think it is that way. Who are you to do this? The thoughts of God are much more superior than ours. Saints, let us be simple and follow the word. For as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven and do not return there, but water the earth and make it bring forth in the bud, that it may give seed to the sower and dread to the eater, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. Every word that Jesus spoke since had a purpose. But unfortunately, those who were listening could not put this word in their hearts. Every word that comes out from the mouth of God, God says that it shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the things for which I sent it. All these words that are coming out in these meetings, these words are not for you to gain a little bit of doctrine and theology, of biblical theory. These words are for God to execute His will. God does not need many that speak their own words. Because God has a channel to speak, and He needs us to execute that which He is saying. I said to my brothers, we are not owners of a lot of biblical doctrine. We are all executors of the word, including me, saints. The words that I speak, I am not a source. If it were my own words, they will not function and not do the will of God. These words are from God, and I myself must also be as an executor, a doer of what God is speaking. We are all doers. Let us take this word onwards. I had lunch today with a few captains. Captains are young people that are taking care of the troops. Mature young people. And I spoke to them saying that the Lord needs all of you to the work of God. You must not only take care of your local church. Our vision is greater than that. It's to preach the gospel to all the land, in all the land, and the edification of the body of Christ. The body of Christ is not a local church. The body of Christ is all the churches. Although I am struggling in my local church, my vision must be amplified to see the work as a whole. Jesus said, raise your eyes and see that the fields are white. Saints, Africa is ready. The fields are white. Ask the owner of the land to send more workers. So you must pray. Because if you pray, you are going to be sent. Do you want to be part of this work? Thank God, at this lunch, I spoke to these mature young people. All of them want to have experience in the work of God. Let us have experience in the work of the Lord to see how and what God is doing. We need many workers, saints. I'm going to tell you a miracle. May I? Because of the needs of Africa, these last conferences, the Young People's Conference, added to this conference, international conference, our goal is to get 1 million Brazilian reais. And we have reached today
660.
In today's morning, with 460,000, there are still 540 for us to fight for. Are you in? And then this afternoon, with little time, we raised with the elders, let us work, let us raise offerings. Do you know what number have we reached? From the 460, we have reached 1,600,000 already. A positive agenda.
Irmãos, esse é o fruto, resultado.
This is the fruit, the result. After Jesus removed all the handbrakes from us, today all that are here have a heart for the Lord. No one is seeking a work for himself or herself. We don't have the concept of position. We are not competing with one another. We are merely members of the body of Christ, and we want to edify the church, doing the will of God, to bring Christ to reign in this earth again. And with this pure heart, the Lord is blessing us, and nobody will stop this. This 1,600,000 won't be just that. There is still many other groups. I believe that many groups of co-porters can enter this. There are still many groups who can enter this. We still have the second weekend of offerings. I believe that we are going to surpass 2 million. If you don't pay attention, it will go to 2.5 million. That's why the Lord is blessing us. The house is full. We have a full house here.
Agenda positiva.
A positive agenda.
Por isso, irmãos, nós devemos ter o mesmo senso de urgência.
We must have the same sense of urgency to the will of God. Not losing time with what is right and wrong. Let us follow the Spirit to produce life and light in people's lives. Because Jesus said, as
João 9, versículo 5. Enquanto estou no mundo, sou a luz do mundo. A igreja é enviada aos povos para abrir os olhos das pessoas e converter esses povos das trevas para a luz e da potestade de Satanás para Deus. Isso está em Atos 26, 18. Dê uma olhada lá. Atos 26 e 18. É a nossa missão. Porque nós temos Jesus como a luz do mundo conosco. Versículo 18. Para lhes abrires os olhos e os converteres das trevas para a luz e da potestade de Satanás para Deus, a fim de que recebam eles remissão de pecados e herança entre os que são santificados pela fé em mim. Pelo que morre a gripa, não foi desobediente à visão celestial. Por isso, irmãos, essa também é a nossa urgência.
This is also our urgency. Let us go out and send this light to the world to remove people's blindness, to convert people from the empire of darkness to light, the power of Satan to God. I'm going to continue in verse 6 of John 9. When he said these things, he spat on the ground and made clay with the saliva, and he anointed the eyes of the blind man, and he said to him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which is translated sent. So he went and washed and came back seeing. Why did Jesus spit on the ground? Man was made from the dust of the ground. And the saliva represents the words that comes out of the envoy. These words that comes out of the mouth of the Lord form with the dust forms a clay.
Irmãos, o tanque de Siloé, aqui já explica, Siloé, que quer dizer enviado. O homem,
the pool of Siloam, which is translated sent. I'm going to read what I wrote here. Man was formed from the dust of the ground, so clay represents human nature. Romans 9, 21.
Ou não tem o oleiro direito sobre a massa para do mesmo barro fazer um vaso para honra e outro para desonra. Esse barro aqui é o homem.
Does not the potter have power over the clay? From the same lump to make one vessel of honor, for honor and another for dishonor? Spitting on the ground means that the saliva, like the word that come out of the mouth of the Lord in Matthew 4:4, rich man as the word made flash.
Isso alcançou o homem como o verbo que se fez carne. João capítulo 1, versículo 14.
John, like John chapter 1, verse 14. To heal him of blindness. Note, appreciate that the healing of blindness comes by the word that proceeds from the mouth of God. But it is necessary that the blind man, after the clay is applied, went to the pool called Sent. Just like the commander from Syria was with leprosy and did not know who could heal him, and there was a lady of Israel, a young girl. And this young girl, she said, there is a prophet in Israel. Go there that he can heal you. So the commander went seeking the prophet. And the prophet did not even come out to meet him, but sent him to take a bath in the Jordan River. And the commander was full of rage, saying that there were better rivers in Syria. But his official said for him to obey. Saints, obeying the envoy is what makes things happen. So the commander obeyed in leprosy, and he was cured from the leprosy. You must humiliate yourself and go to the envoy, because the word of God received by man through faith becomes the spirit that anoints. Luke 4:18-19. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. So the Spirit of the Lord anoints in order for us to preach the gospel to the poor, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind. This Spirit that anoints is in 2 Corinthians 1, verses 21 and 22. For since in the wisdom of God, now he who establishes us with you in Christ and has anointed us is God, who also has sealed us and given us the Spirit in our hearts as a guarantee. This can be translated as he who unites us with you in Christ. Thus, by the word, God unites the apostle together with those who receive the word and has anointed us together with the anointed one, who has also sealed us and given us as a pledge the Spirit in our hearts. What is this? Let us go to 1 John, chapter 1. That which from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled concerning the word of life. It is the word of life, is Jesus Christ. The life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and declare to you that the eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested to us. So this word of life, it was the eternal life itself, who was Jesus Christ himself. It is the word that John, as the apostle, bore witness to the saints. In this word, being received has an effect. It makes so that those who believe are united with the apostle. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. This word unites you with the envoy. That's why you must go to the pool of Siloam. Let us see in the verse 3. That which you have seen and heard, we declare to you, that you may also have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son, Jesus Christ. That is, when John declared to the people, these people received, and those who received started to have fellowship with John. And this fellowship is through the word. And this fellowship is a fellowship of life. That is why the prophetic word becomes the element of fellowship. This prophetic word is promoting fellowships among us. When we do the immersion and we speak with one another, what are we doing? When you accept the word, you become connected to the one who is speaking. And when you do that, you become connected with Jesus Christ and His Father. And these words start to circulate among us as blood. And all the cells in the body receives oxygen and nutrition in order to be healthy. Since we are receiving this word circulating among us, and we are being nourished also with oxygen. And you know that when you combine nutrition with oxygen, there is combustion. How does your car take you anywhere? You put gas, petrol, and then there is, in your engine, there is the fuel and oxygen.
Pressiona e acende uma centelha pela vela
And then there's an explosion with oxygen and the fuel and the compressed air, and it starts to function. The engine starts to function, to combust, and there's energy to take you anywhere. The rice and beans that you eat, the blood, receives nutrition, because you eat, and when the food reaches your intestine will start to get the nutrition to your blood. Then you will also need oxygen in order for the combustion. That's why your lungs work removing carbon dioxide and inhaling oxygen, so that in every cell there is combustion, so that you have energy to preach the gospel. In spiritually speaking, it is the same thing. We need this, the word that is our nourishment, and the spirit that is our oxygen, to preach the gospel and bring the Lord back. So let us make the word circulate among us. Then we are connected. Then we are sealed. I don't know how to explain it better. Then the blind man obeyed, went, washed, and came back seeing. When you believe and you obey with simplicity, you are cured. Let us go on. I need to finish. John 9. Therefore, the neighbors and those who previously had seen that he was blind said, "It is not this he who sat and wept?" Some said, "This is he." Others said, "He is like him." He said, "I am he." Therefore, they said to him, "How are your eyes opened?" He answered and said, "A man called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes, and said to me, 'Go to the pool of Siloam and wash.' So I went and washed, and I received sight." What are you seeing today? Who cured you of your blindness? Then you must speak, "I went, I washed, now I see." And then, from verse 13 to 16 comes the complication of the Jews. Again, Jesus had not kept the Sabbath. Some said he was not from God. Verse 16. Therefore, some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, because he does not keep the Sabbath." Others said, "How can a man who is a sinner do such things?" And there was a division among them. Since the natural man does not understand the things of God. And in verse 24, they called the blind man, was called again. How did the Lord cure a blind man from birth? How can you cure a man who was blinded from birth? Perhaps he didn't have all the proper organs of his eyes, because he was born blind. But with just one word, everything was restored. You cannot explain this. That's why he is the great I am. He is the existence himself. He brings to existence. His vision was restored. Look at the power of the word. That's why when you go out to the street and you ask if the person has a prayer request, you need only to pray for the prophetic word. And then the person will be touched and cry. What is happening is the power of the word. It is not your word, but the word of God. That's why saints, Jews did not believe that he was blind and called his parents to confirm. And his parents, afraid of the Jews, asked him to question because he's old. So they called him a second time and said, and what did he say at verse 24? So they called again the man who was blind and said to him, give God the glory, we know that this man is a sinner. They were talking about Jesus here, the sinner. He answered and said, whether he's a sinner or not, I do not know. One thing I know, that though I was blind, now I see. Saints, Satan can raise many attacks against us, but there are no arguments against facts. How many people were cured? How many teenagers had their lives radically changed for the better? How many miracles are happening every day? It is crazy what's happening. I cannot even tell all the facts. I don't know what happened. I just know that I was blind. Now I see. So the testimony, the witness, is the stronger word. Jesus established a principle in John 1:39. Come and see. Don't discuss with all these people. Thank God our teenagers don't know much about the Bible, because they do this work very well. When people stop you at the streets, asking, what church are you from? You will try to explain it to them, that the church has not a name, does not have a name. You say that you are part of the reality of the church in every local city. But the teenagers are bringing 10, 15, 20 people to the church, because they're only saying, come and see. Those who are talking too much, stop talking too much. Let us bring people, come and see. I don't have much time. I have to finish. I'm going to the verse 35. Jesus heard that they had cast him out. They had cast the blind man out. And when he had found him, he said to me, do you believe in the Son of God? He answered and said, who is he, Lord, that I may believe in him? And Jesus said to him, you have both seen, and he is who is talking with you. And then he said, Lord, I believe, and he worshipped him. He was saved. Then, verse 39. I think this is a crucial verse, important verse here. I want to finish making this verse very clear. And Jesus said, "For judgment I have come into this world, that those who do not see may see, and that those who see may be blind." How is this? I came to this world for judgment. What type of judgment? That those who do not see may see, and that those who see may be made blind. Those who truly confess himself or herself of being blind will see. And those who are blind but think that they can see will become truly blind. So Jesus came to this world for judgment. When Jesus passes, these 3.5 years he went by, nothing is going to be indefinite. Either you are at one side of the wall or you are another. Nothing is kept on top of the wall. Where Jesus goes by, there is judgment. You cannot say, "I'm neutral." Jesus will say, "There's not this third position." Jesus came to give order. Either you let the Lord keep you in order, or you will stand on the other side in disorder. This conference is going to be this judgment, this division. Nobody should stand on the wall. We are those who do not see, but now are seeing. We are not the arrogant who thought we knew how to speak, how to do the will of God. No, we are blind. We are lame. We are not capable of doing anything. But we believe in the word of power. And this word of power will do all the work. That's why those who were blind are seeing. This is the judgment that God is doing. While it is not definitive, the work of God will not go on. When you define yourself, then the Lord has a way of going onwards. This conference is to have this definition. Nobody must be left on top of the wall. These offerings is a record. It is a proof that all have been defined. The Lord has not any blockage anymore. Traitors, unbelievers, then the Lord can go on. Let us go on. I'm going to stop here. Let us go on. Amen.